the rest was just looking after the baby.
Drama's tough. I mean, I would say comedy's a little bit more tougher, but, you know, having a script like this by what the trailer looks like, I mean, the complexities of what the emotional relationship is between the husband and wife. I mean, the husband basically is basically almost hapless, you know, with the incident that when it happened. The wife has a post-traumatic stress. There is a very interesting, you know, dynamic between the two, even just through the trailer, you can just watch it, the, you know, difficulties between the two as well. I mean, you know, just going through the edits and watching the story kind of come out and the performances come out as well. Was it hard at times to kind of see that relationship between the two kind of disintegrate? I mean, obviously it gets a little bit emotional there.
It was just a matter of looking through the performances and, well, first of all, you have to go on set knowing that you'll be edited. So there was never a question who was editing the film. So I knew what I was shooting and I wouldn't move on till I knew what I was getting. And it was a clean pack up and let's move on. Because I was editing in my head as I was directing. So I was like, all right, well, this shot goes with that and this shot goes with that. Okay, cool. But we've got a scene now, you know? And I don't know if you've seen the film yet, but, you know, a lot of it is just, it's very, very, very simply filmed. It's just a wide to establish the scene and then, you know, over the shoulder to do dialogue. And a film shouldn't be anything other than a simple telling of a story. There's no need to overcomplicate it with fancy shots or anything like that. So I knew going into it what I was getting because I was the editor. So when it came time to actually edit, because I was so close to the material, I knew where to look. I knew where to pull the emotion from. I knew which shots worked and which takes didn't work. I knew what days the actors were off, you know. And that's a luxury I have making an indie film because I don't have to report to anyone. I don't have to rely on a third person to subconsciously know these things about the material because I went in there knowing it already. So the editing was actually really easy. There was never a moment where I was stunned or going, oh, we have to do a reshoot or anything like that. And again, because I was directing it, I knew that I wouldn't move on till I got the emotional performances that I needed to. So yeah, honestly, I'm not trying to sound, you know, so overly, you know, I'm not trying to make it sound like it was the most easiest thing in the world, but, you know, I really can't think of any challenges that I had in getting emotion out of the performances and then cutting it into the film. It is a drama. It is a drama, but it's also a very, very hard mix of a thriller as well. So we are marketing it as a thriller, not so much a drama, because it's almost like we start off as a drama, we lean into thriller territory and then go back to a drama. But to me, drama, thriller, it's the same type of story. One is just a bit more suspenseful and terrifying than the other, you know. But I never thought about how it would come out. I never thought about whether or not the mixture of genres would be so defined. And, you know, some people have gotten back to me and, is this a drama? Is it a thriller? I'm like, well, it's both. Why can't it be both? It's a mix of genres. So the drama aspect of it, I knew we were facing an uphill battle because, one, we're Australian. Two, it's a 2.5-hour film. And three, it's a drama. How are you going to sell that, right? Whereas if it was an hour and a half thriller that is a police procedural, it'd be much easier to sell. I really didn't care, to be honest with you. I mean, it was like, well, I wanted to make a slow-burning film. It's been, you know, our lawyer described it as a Nordic noir type of film, and I've never ever heard that expression before until he mentioned it. It's a Nordic noir. And I thought, well, yeah, subconsciously I was going for that slow-burning, you know, Nordic crime procedural that does have those elements of drama, that do have those human interactions and characters coming together. And it was just a big gel and a big mix. And in the edit, you really do start to see where one thread stops and the other one keeps going. And I didn't really want to, you know, cut it down for time because of people's inability to stay on a screen for 2 hours. It's you know, it's a story that is the story. And if I can't get your attention for 2.5 hours out of your day, then there's a lot of older films that you won't appreciate because this was a very, very conscious effort to nod back to the films of the 60s and 70s, the noir, detective noir film. Yeah, that's where we ended up, but very, very mixed results. Very mixed results, and I'm pretty happy with it because it's a mix of genre.
We'll be back with John Balazs right after this.
In terms of length, I was just talking to a director about that, and you know, you never know how, you know, how short or how long a story is going to be, just because, you know, the story is going to be the story, you know, and that seems to be the current theme. I mean, his film was, you know, 83 minutes. Yours is 2.5 hours. Mine's the one that I'm doing. We're in editing right now. Mm-hmm. Mine's going to be a little bit over an hour, and that's all it's going to be. So sometimes it's just that ends up happening where the story lends itself to being a longer story versus maybe a shorter story, or sometimes it does that as well. I mean, and all that also just has to go with pacing. You know, you have to, when you're going through that editing process, there's that pacing, you know, of the clips as well. I mean, how did the pacing come out for you in terms of the edit?
Well, look, obviously pacing, it's a slow film. It's a slow burner. And Richard Norton and I had a very, very, had many conversations about this, and we decided that in the day and age of people flying around in metal costumes throwing fridges at each other, we wanted to slow things down a bit. We really just wanted to allow characters to think and to breathe and to be on screen. We wanted to give them that extra minute, that extra couple of seconds, that beat, just to see them thinking about something, or just that moment before they want to say something, or that moment after they realize something. And those type of films are very rare now because, you know, going back to what you were saying, it's people need that time. They need, okay, this is an hour and a half, you know, and then after that I've got to do this, I've got to do that. And people's schedule gets so busy nowadays, and they'll be watching a movie and they'll have their iPhone in front of them and an iPad in between that, and then, you know, then the TV. It's hard to get people's attention. And I deliberately went, no, if you're going to watch this, I need all of your attention. So that's why there are scenes that do play out long, because in those scenes, I'm giving you five bits of information in act one that you're going to have to really concentrate, because they're going to pop up in act three, you know. And if you don't get it, you've just missed out on an experience there. You missed out on a discovery. You missed out on this journey. But Richard Norton and I were very adamant on going, just let them be, let the characters be, let them roll, let them think, you know. And that taught me not to cut early. That taught me to just keep things smooth, keep things rolling. And, you know, to me, it's refreshing to see things like that. It's refreshing to see something where a character and a story can just evolve naturally without the restrictions of time. And, you know, this is a very naive thing for me to say, because no studio film would ever allow you to do this, but that's the beauty of being an indie. You can do what you want, basically. You don't have to answer to anyone, as long as you've got a good product at the end. So in terms of pacing, when it came to editing, there were some scenes that I cut because they were irrelevant or they didn't flow too well. And obviously, you know, I didn't want to make a 3-hour film, but I did cut it down to what I thought was the acceptable amount of time to tell this story. And again, I can only get away with that now. I would never be able to get away with it on a bigger budget film controlled by, you know, a studio or a corporation. There's no way you can get away with that. But because I knew I could, I just did it. And the other thing about the pacing is that the film does start off with a lot of action. It starts off with a home invasion. It starts off with violence. It starts off with people getting shot. It starts off with you know, two murders. But then that's my way of saying, all right, here's the tone of the film for you guys. Now join us on the rest of the journey, which is this dissection of a marriage and this police investigation. And then it really does pick up back in Act 3. So it's almost like Act 2 is a valley and Act 1 and Act 3 are these big hills that demand your utmost attention. So as far as pacing goes, I knew that it was that kind of pattern. So if I was to draw the film out, it would be two mountains and a valley, you know. And that's the way I just saw it. And, you know, it was just one of those things that ended up happening organically. Going back now, I probably would have shot, you know, maybe a couple of scenes just a tad faster and just told the actors to walk in and out a bit slower. But yeah, I really don't have any regrets in shooting it the way I did.
I think it's a lost art in terms of, you know, well, I think the old expression is that it's not, drama's not, you know, drama is kind of almost about silence sometimes, you know, where those silent moments hit. And, you know, I love the idea that you're talking about, the idea of having to think, because sometimes, you know, we're kind of all into like, we gotta do things quick. We have to do things quick, and we don't think. And, you know, you want those moments where they're kind of, you know, thinking, you know, why, you know, why should I say this? Or why should I, you know, why should I say this? Should I say something? Should I not say something?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I absolutely love that idea, you know, in terms of acting. And I hope that it comes back a little bit more, just so, because everything's so fast paced nowadays, you know, sometimes you just got to stop and think. And
yes,
I wouldn't say stop and smell the roses, but, you know, stop and just have that motivation, or, you know, just that once, you know, one breath to kind of, you know, release all the tension, as it were.
Correct. And look, honestly, you know, there is, and I'll give you an example here. There are two scenes that are almost side to side of the husband trying to connect with the wife. So, you know, there's a scene of them in bed, and he's saying what he misses about her and what he wants to go back to the way things were, you know. And obviously the big thing about the film is that she doesn't speak. She's completely verbally withdrawn from the world. So she can't even help the police in identifying who the attacker was, because her ability to speak has just completely vanished through trauma. Then the following scene, it's almost the same scene where the husband and the wife are the husband's trying to really connect with her. And this is now moved to a lakeside. So it's gone from the bedroom to the lakeside. There's a transition there, but I don't want to ruin it. And a lot of people have come back to me and said, why did you put these two scenes side by side? They're the same scene. It's him pleading with her. My argument to them is, did you really listen to the scene? Because the first time he's expressing his needs, his regrets, his wants, his guilt, his shame. The second time in the scene following, he realizes, well, that's not what she needed. She needed an apology. She needed me to own up to what I've done, not project my needs onto her. And as soon as I tell that to people, they're like, these two scenes are so different. They have two separate meanings, but fundamentally it's a husband and wife talking, but the scenes are stitched together back to back. So that's when I think, well, really pay attention to the words here, because obviously Michael, the scriptwriter, took a long time, took a lot of time and a lot of study and a lot of dedication here to find the right words to portray the journey of these characters. And on a second viewing, you know, the people that I have shown it to realize, wow, okay, that's something that I never thought before. I've got a better appreciation now for these little subtleties in films. And I'm like, well, I feel great about that. I feel great about the fact that now someone can go away and realize, you know what? There are things in the negative spaces, like you said, there are things in the silence. There are things in the there's power in the words not being spoken, so to say. And it takes, I think, someone with a real maturity to understand that on film, because, you know, a certain look, a certain breath can mean 100 different things. And you really have to stay on it to really interpret it the right way. That's my rant.
And, I mean, a lot of that too is you know, body language too. You know, I think we say so much about the words, but the ability to have that body language, you know, kind of, you know, emit what a feeling is or how somebody is. I mean, huge, and especially if there's a silence in there as well. So, I mean, that, I think works very, very well as well with your film.
Yeah, it was a silence was always a big thing for me, and, you know, not having characters explain everything to the audience, you know, just watch it. Things are set up beautifully in the frame. It's shot very well by our DOP. You know, everything's there for a reason. Even our production designer, all the colors in the background, they're there for a reason. You know, and you might not pick it up. You might not pick it up, and that's okay. We're creating 24 frames, and we're trying to paint every time we create a frame. Things are there. Things are there for a reason, and all I really ask from an audience is just to slow down, just breathe a bit, and go on this journey of these people and everyone else they draw in on their journey.